Well, good morning. Trust that you're having a good morning and it wasn't your car that was in the ditch. Hopefully everything is going smoothly for you. Want to encourage you this morning too, as far as men's ministry, I've been asked about men's fraternity, when we're starting up. We are going to be having a meal on January 23rd, which is coming up a couple weeks. On a Monday night, there's a sign-up sheet out in the foyer, so please feel free to sign that up. You don't need to be part of anything, just if you're a guy and you want to come for a meal. I'll be doing a devotional. We'll have some testimonies, and we're looking forward to that. So sign up for that if you get a chance. Also, we will be starting up a new study called Modern Parables, part of the what we're going to be doing this year with our men's ministry, and that starts the first Monday night after the Super Bowl. So looking forward to that after the Super Bowl, that Monday night. All right. Well, if you need a Bible, we are in Joshua chapter 8 this morning. These men would love to put one in your hands. If you don't have your Bible here today, feel free to avail yourself of that. Absolutely take advantage of that here today. We are in Joshua chapter 8 on this nice snowy morning. Wasn't it great to get up this morning and have no humidity? I just love that. That is just wonderful. I walked out there with the dog and it was like, you know, there's no humidity this morning. This is just great. 16 degrees, but no humidity. Joshua chapter 8 is a neat passage of scripture. In fact, I hope that you're enjoying Joshua as I've been enjoying it. There are certain challenges from this passage of scripture today that really stand out in my mind. Joshua chapter 7, just to give you a little bit of background, the people of Israel had marched around Jericho, and on that last day, the trumpets and shouts and the walls come down, and you know the story. There's absolute victory for the people of Israel as they're coming across the Jordan River, and they have that huge fortified city to deal with. And God gives them tremendous victory. But there were certain things that were requirements of the people of Israel. One, that they couldn't touch anything that was there. Unfortunately, there was a man named Achan and his family that violated the ban. And they stole certain things, certain items, and buried them in the bottom of their tent. When that was discovered later on in chapter 7, it's discovered after the people of Israel have gone up to take another fortified city called Ai. I know in the Hebrew you might pronounce that I, but I grew up pronouncing it Ai, and so I'm going to keep on doing that if you don't mind. Too old now to change, too many things, right? Well, truth of the matter is, the people of Ai, or I, routed the people of Israel. They only had sent up 3,000 men. The men were turned around and beaten back, and 36 of them died in the process. It was a terrible time. People of Israel weren't supposed to have that type of defeat in the Promised Land, but that's, alas, what did happen. By the time you come to chapter 8, the sin of Achan has been dealt with. And it's an opportunity for the people of Israel to start freshly as they've come into this new land. There are multiple types of spiritual lessons that can be learned. One lesson that you learn right off the bat is the fact that God does not tolerate sin. A million people plus, no doubt, at this point in time, and many of them go into Jericho, and as God had said to them, you aren't supposed to touch anything because all these things belong to me, almost everyone obeyed, except for Achan and his family. And the result was tragic. God is a God who does not tolerate sin. We have to keep that in the back of our minds, because by the time we come to the end of chapter 8 this morning, it's a message of grace and there's a message of hope, but it's on the other side. God, first of all, establishes the fact that when it comes to sin is a very serious issue. And so God blends together the fact that sin is very significant with a tremendous message of hope and grace. And that we find to be very, very encouraging for us. Now, the people of Israel are going to start a journey at this point in time. And it's a journey where I guess I would have to say that doing things the right way is all important. Here in chapter 8 and verse 1, it says, "Now the Lord said to Joshua, 'Do not fear, or be dismayed. There were some good things that were about to happen, but we need to do it the right way. Let's look to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Ask God to bless. Father God, we come to you this morning and we ask that you would bless your word. Father, help us to learn the significance of doing these things the right way. Father, our flesh pulls us away from you. We're tempted to do things on our own. We're tempted to violate your word. We're tempted to be disobedient. And at times, Lord, we yield to that. And Father, we know that the consequences of yielding to those things are serious. Help us, Lord, to purpose in our heart and our minds today to do things according to your word, to be obedient and see the blessings that come from obedience and all the good things that you have for your children. I pray this all in Christ's name now. Amen. Well, there's been a lot of good ideas in the world. This was one of those great ideas. This was one of the first sliding boards that was ever invented. And you can see that the kids are having a great time. If you've ever tried to slide down a sliding board, and literally that's a piece of wood, there are slivers that no doubt could enter the equation. And there is a great amount of friction that keeps you from actually sliding. So when these kids got on the sliding board, they just sat there. And consequently, over time, people figured out there must be better ways to improve this. And we can do it a better way. Maybe if you were there when this was happening, you'd go back to the house and dip into the bowl of lard that you have in the cupboard and smear that all over that board. How about some bear grease, huh? How many of you ever use wax paper? Oh, several of you, on to that secret, showing your age. You see, the new sliding boards are made out of this great plastic that's kind of slippery. I go on those with my grandson. We just about are in peril together. It's exciting to be able to come flying down these loop-de-loop things. It's just a better way. And the people of Israel here in Joshua are finding out that there's a way that you really don't want to go, and there's a way that really makes a lot of sense. So when God says to Joshua, "Do not fear or be dismayed," he is giving him tremendous words of encouragement. In fact, these are very similar words that Moses spoke in Kadesh Barnea. Moses said directly to Joshua earlier, and Joshua chapter 1, these are the words God spoke to Joshua directly. Don't fear, don't be dismayed. There's a good way to do this. We're on the right track. We're going to go in the right direction. These are great words of encouragement. I picked this up here in this passage of Scripture, and I want you to see that God has a plan, and it's really worth following God's plan. God will say to him, he says, "Take all the people of war with you and arise and go up to Ai. See, I have given into your hand the king of Ai, his people, his city, his land. And you'll do to him just like you did to the people of Jericho and its king. You shall take its spoil and its cattle as plunder for yourselves. Set an ambush for the city," he says, "behind it." How different this one is. Jericho, things were under the ban. Things were set aside for God. But God says now, he says, when you go into Ai, feel free to help yourselves to certain things. God is going to produce blessing, but it's always going to be according to his way of obedience. And so Joshua, don't fear, don't be dismayed. I've got great plans for you. We're going to go up there to Ai, and this time we're not going to get beat because you're going to follow the prescription for success exactly. Notice what God says right after that. I find it curious there in verse 2. It just kind of like explodes there, but it says, "Set an ambush for the city behind it." God has a unique plan for capturing Ai. I'd love to know what Joshua thought when God gave him this plan. Do you remember the first time they just got done fighting Jericho and it really wasn't much of a fight and they've got this tremendous victory and the people, he says, you know, okay, the next city up there is Ai. We're going to march up there to Ai and take them. He sends a couple of guys up there and they come back and say, "Look, no problem, Joshua. Give me 3,000 guys. We'll go take care of it." This time around, God tells Joshua to send 30,000. That's, depending on how good your math is, 10 times what they sent originally. 30,000 valiant warriors, the Bible says, are to go up there, and Joshua is going to send them out at night. He commanded them, saying, "See, you are going to ambush the city from behind. Don't go very far from the city, but all of you be ready. And then I and the people who are with me will approach the city, and when they come out to meet us at the first, we'll flee before them, and they'll come out after us. And then when we've drawn them away from the city, they'll say they're fleeing like they did the first time. And so we will flee before them, and you will rise from your ambush and take possession of the city, for the Lord your God will deliver it into your hand. And it will be when you have seized the city that you'll set it on fire, and you'll do according to all the words of the Lord. See, I've commanded you." And so Joshua sent them away, and they went to the place of ambush and remained between Bethel and Ai on the west side of Ai. But Joshua spent that night among the people. God gives to Joshua a divine plan of this is what you should be doing. This was a neat plan. It's such a military strategy that other military outfits over the decades and centuries and millennium have been following the same thing. You'll notice here on the map that the people of Israel had come along this eastern side. They crossed the Jordan River here, and the Bible tells us that they were encountering Jericho here. They lodge at a place called Gilgal, and it's there that they're encamped. They go up into this mountainous area, this western hill country, as it were, and they encounter a little town called Ai, which is just to the east of Bethel. Let me give you another map. This gives you the idea of the topography of the land. Up until this point, the people of Israel have been down in that valley area, and they've come to Jericho. They're residing then at Gilgal after the victory. They're going to go up this mountain pass to the place here where my green dot is. That is where Ai is, just to the east of Bethel. And what God tells them to do is very significant. For he tells them that basically there's going to be a force of 5,000 that are going to continue in this valley, and they are going to come up to this area of Bethel. Now, Bethel is separated from Ai with a valley. The people there in that group, the ambush group, 5,000 of them will stay down in that valley, and the people from Ai and Bethel will not be able to see them. Meanwhile, Joshua will take 25,000 men, and he will approach the city in a unique way. You would normally take that pass up and go between Bethel and Ai. This was strategic, because Ai would be on the east, Bethel would be on the west, and you would have to pass through the middle, and so you could defend that central plateau area by armies that would try to go up through there. What Joshua does is he goes not through this valley, but he cuts off earlier, and he goes around to the north side of Ai. There is a valley, as I mentioned, between Ai on the north side as well as on the west side. All of the people will be able to see very clearly Joshua and his 25,000 valiant warriors. The people of Bethel will come to the aid of the people of Ai. When they see all of those warriors there, they're going to come down through that valley, and amazingly, and I'll get to this in a moment, they can't see the 5,000 because they've come at night and they are hiding out there. They're all, once they see the 25,000, they're all there in Ai. That is, all the men of Bethel are with the men of Ai. Joshua is going to go from the north side of Ai to the east side and approach the city head on that way. When he does it, the people, according to the scriptures here, the people say, "Oh, look, he's coming. He's coming the same way they came before," and they go out to engage them. They go out to engage them, and as soon as they come against Joshua and the valiant warriors, all of a sudden they go to pieces, and they turn around, and they run away, run away, run away. And as they're run away, and they're screaming, oh, 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 the people of Ai and Bethel are thinking to themselves, good, we're going to whoop on them again. And they go tearing off to whoop on them. Now, you'll notice here that there is quite a bit of hill country here. And it would be easy for them to run away quite a distance and get down into this tremendously sloped area. But evidently, before they get there, Joshua is going to, according to verse 18, stretch out his javelin, and it's going to signal to the 5,000 who are down in the valley that indeed all the people have come out of Ai. And when they come out of Ai, the 5,000 will come up out of the valley behind the city, and there's no resistance in the city. And they go into the city, and they set the city on fire. The warriors that are pursuing Joshua and the 25,000 don't see it because their backs are turned to the city. And all of a sudden, Joshua signals, that's enough, we're not running anymore, and he turns around. And there are the guys from Ai, and all of a sudden they realize, we're outnumbered here 2-1. And this is a big problem. And they realize that these guys aren't going to run away like the 3,000 ran away. And when they turn around to look to go back to Ai, guess what? Ai is on fire, the smoke is in the air, and there's 5,000 more valiant warriors coming at them from that direction. And they disperse, they go in all kinds of directions, and the people of Israel are able to gain a tremendous, tremendous victory. Now, God is a strategist, isn't he? He's pretty amazing, isn't he? Well, it was interesting because there's so much detail here given in Joshua chapter 7. We could spend the next couple of hours just pulling apart chapter 7 and chapter 8 and seeing all of these details. But I love the geography and I love the detail given to, you know, the fact that the people of Israel would be on the north side and on the west side, and this is how it would all come together. Modern archaeologists were trying to figure out if this was true. They looked at Joshua and they thought, well, there's a lot of specifics that are mentioned here, and they set out to try to find Bethel and Ai. And this was their conclusion. One archaeologist said, this evidence shows that the narrative in Joshua is not to be taken literally. Archaeology has wiped out the historical credibility of the conquest of Ai as reported in Joshua 7 and 8. Another one said, there is no evidence of a Canaanite city at this spot or any other site in the region. This constitutes unequivocal archaeological evidence for the lack of correlation between the story of Joshua 8 with all its topographic details and a historical reality corresponding to the period of the conquest. Another said this, Ai is simply an embarrassment to every view of the conquest that takes the biblical and archaeological evidence seriously. Oh, so what are we to believe? Archaeologists, science is saying basically this didn't happen. There was a fellow by the name of David Livingstone. Have you ever heard of David Livingstone? Not the same guy. There's no E on the end of his name. But nonetheless, he was very significant. He was actually studying in Jerusalem when he heard all this rhetoric about how you couldn't possibly believe in the reality of this conquest because there's no place where this has been found. And so he started thinking to himself, and he thought, maybe the historians and science is wrong and not the Bible. So he set out to find Ai. This gave rise to a group of people who are still in existence today, the Associates for Biblical Research, or ABR. And they began to look where the liberal archaeologists had looked for Ai. And of course, it wasn't there, but given the descriptions of Bethel and Ai, they were able to piece some things together, and they were able to find its location, just as the Bible said. I watched an interview between the persons that were doing some of the excavation work, and one of the times when they were there, he actually was able to find the gate socket to Ai. The gate socket is the place where you hang the gate. It's a special stone carved out with the circle, and you can hang the, you know, and the, you know what I mean? And so they found it. And he was so excited. They're all a bunch of kids, you know. They're all just like, oh, yeah, and so-and-so found it. It was just fantastic. And from that place, they could look and they could see exactly where Joshua's 25,000 would be. They could look across at Bethel, but they couldn't see the 5,000 in the valley. It was just phenomenal what they could piece together and what they could easily understand. And so it was a very significant find. And so this was really enlightening. And it goes to show again that God has given his word, and his word is trustworthy. How neat it is. They began to excavate it, and some of those stones, my wife is reminding me that some of those walls were there in 1982 when we were there. And she said, remember how big of a deal that was? She has a better memory than I have. I kind of remember being there, but she remembers, so that's awesome. I'm gonna have to go back through and dig up some of our pictures that we have from 1982. But you know, it's so fascinating, because what they find there is that this city, Ai, was a fortified city, that the walls were some 4 meters thick, and so it was important, it was very important to get these men that were in that city out so that you could conquer it. Think about what would have happened if God, in a miraculous way, had not taken out the walls of Jericho. That could have been a siege that had lasted for years. I want you to know that the entire period of conquest that we're talking about here is 6 years. That's not enough time to lay siege to every one of these fortified cities. And so what God is doing is he's working this out so that this doesn't have to be a long, protracted time. Pretty exciting to see God's handiwork, isn't it? So neat to be able to see how biblical archaeologists can go and how they can find all of these very important points. And the conclusion that ABR had was that whoever wrote this account in Joshua chapter 8 had to have been an eyewitness. And he lists all of these facts. I'd love to take the time, but all of these facts that point to the fact that this was an eyewitness. Kind of like a murder mystery where no one knows what the instrument of murder was, but this one person says, oh, well, he was killed with a hammer. Well, how did you know if you weren't the murderer? The idea is that here's an eyewitness. How do you know all of those things have happened? Well, you know because you were there. God is doing a tremendous, miraculous work that should not be overlooked. I want to take your attention down to verse 30 this morning. And I want you to see that right after this tremendous blessing and all these things that are going on, Joshua sees the importance of fulfilling something that was given him to do all the way back in Deuteronomy. It was a very, very important time. If you take your Bibles and go back with me to Deuteronomy, go back with me to Deuteronomy and chapter 27. In chapter 27, we read about instruction that comes to the people of Israel from Moses. And it's a very important instruction. And there are certain things that just get me really excited when I read this, because the people of Israel, when they get this instruction from Moses, they don't know what the circumstances surrounding it are. And we put these pieces together. And that's what we're doing this morning. We're putting these pieces together. Bible says in verse 1, Moses and the elders of Israel charged the people, saying, keep all the commandments which I command you today. So it shall be on that day when you cross the Jordan to the land which the Lord has given you, that you'll set up for yourself large stones and coat them with lime and write on them all the words of the law when you cross over, so that you may enter the land which the Lord your God gives you, a land flowing with milk and honey, as the Lord the God of your fathers promised you. So it shall be when you cross the Jordan, you'll set up on Mount Ebal these stones. And as I am commanding you today, you will coat them with lime. Moreover, you'll build an altar to the Lord your God, an altar of stones, You shall not wield an iron tool on them. You'll build the altar of the Lord your God of uncut stones, and you'll offer it burnt offerings there to the Lord your God, and you'll sacrifice peace offerings and eat there and rejoice before the Lord your God. You'll write on the stones all the words of the law very distinctly. And then Moses says this to the Levitical priests. He says, this day you have become a people for the Lord your God. You'll therefore obey the Lord your God and do his commandments and his statutes, which I command you today. This is before, obviously, Moses has died. He hasn't gone into the promised land, but it's something that was not forgotten. Picking this up in Joshua 8:30, Joshua built an altar to the Lord in Mount Ebal, just as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded the sons of Israel. As it is written in the book of the law, an altar of uncut stones on which no man has wielded an iron tool, and they offered burnt offerings on it to the Lord. He wrote there the stones, a copy of the law of Moses, which he had written in the presence of the sons of Israel. And so all of these things were done. In verse 34, it says, then afterward he read all the words of the law, the blessings, the cursings, according to all that's written in the book of the law. There was not a word of that Moses had commanded, which Joshua did not read before the assembly of Israel, with the women and the little ones and the strangers who were living among them. Let me give you this picture. The people of Israel are going to go on a tremendous march. And this map will show you what Joshua is doing. Again, they cross here, they go into this hill country, approximately here is Bethel, and way up here is Ebal and Gerizim. Ebal and Gerizim are like matching mountains. They're huge, big mountains. They are 30 miles from Ai. And it's not 30,000 valiant warriors who are going up. Everyone is going up. And so the people of Israel who were camped down more so in the plain area here, or this valley area here in Gilgal, are now going to come up through this pass, and they are going to come into really what is the central part of the promised land. From those mountaintops, almost the entirety of the promised land is visible. Now, it's pretty amazing. But what God is doing is he's bringing his people to learn some very, very important spiritual lessons. As Moses would say in Deuteronomy 27, this is a time of rejoicing. The people of Israel are thrilled. God is producing victory after victory, and there is reason now to be absolutely encouraged. Those mountaintops that you see there, that hill country is about 3,000 feet above sea level. When the valley is at different times of year, and this would be one of those times, a time of a rainy season, there would be tremendous greenery there. And these mountains, Ebal and Gerizim, would actually come together at one place. And it is there that they would build that altar on Ebal. F.B. Meyer writes, he says, he describes it as a place where the mountains are hollowed out and the limestone stratum is broken into a succession of ledges so as to present the appearance of a series of regular benches. In other words, this is a natural amphitheater. Isn't that cool? God's people, they didn't know where this was all going to take place back in Deuteronomy 27 when Moses said, this is what I want you to do. They didn't know the circumstances. They didn't know that this could have possibly happened after chapter 7 if they were just following along. But no, this is the perfect timing for this. This is a time of rejoicing. And so all the people of Israel go up to Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal, and it's there that they sit in this amphitheater. And it's not only the men, it's not only the women, it's the women and the children and the men. The entire family unit would come together, and they would listen to the entirety of the law being read. Here's this ceremony. The ceremony goes like this. The first thing they needed to do was build an altar of uncut stones. And they would put those uncut stones together and form that altar on Ebal. Joshua would then take those big tablets and he would cover them with lime. And when you covered them with lime, they stood out, because you want to guess what color that is? Brilliant white. And he was to write the entirety of the law on them. Inscriptions in Iran that were writings that they had were three times longer than Deuteronomy. It is very possible for them to have taken certain stones and written the entirety of the law so that the people could see it. And it would be something that would be so brilliant that it would be seen from afar. The third thing they did in that ceremony, so they built the altar, they wrote out the law on these white stones, and then they read it. It's an entire process. They read every word of the law. Now, the significance of reading the entirety of the law to all of the people shouldn't be missed. There was no ignorance of the law. Get the idea? Ignorance of the law is what? No excuse. You remember that? That was always like on cop shows and stuff. Oh, yeah, the ignorance of the law. Is no. Yeah, it was like, oh, yeah. And it's like, that's my number one excuse, right? I mean, you get pulled over. Do you know how fast you're going? No, I have no idea what the speed limit is. I purposely don't pay attention. Did you see that red light? What red light? You know, it's like, God is taking the law, and all of it in its entirety is being read. And there's not even children there who could say, I deny ever hearing that. Because they were all going to hear the aspect of it. Here's what's so significant. Go back with me, if you would like to Deuteronomy 27, and you'll see the distinctions here that were to be made. Moses is going to charge the people when he says this. He says to them, he says, you're going to basically be doing two different things with the law and the reading of the law. He says, basically, in verse 15, he says, there are curses and then there are blessings. You say, well, what's all that about? Here he says, in verse 15, he gives an example. Cursed is the man who makes an idol or a molten image an abomination to the Lord, the work of the hands of the craftsman, and sets it up in secret. And the Bible says, all the people shall answer and say, amen. As they're reading the law and as they're reading these different sections, there were curses that were to be read. The people were to acknowledge that they had heard that curse, that they had agreed with that curse. That's what it means when they say, amen. That's what happens in church when somebody says amen, right? And then there were, look at chapter 28 of Deuteronomy, there were also blessings. And he says, all these blessings will come upon you and overtake you, verse 2, if you obey the Lord your God. And verse 3 gives an example. Blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the country. Amen. I agree with that. And this was to be done with the people of Israel, so that they understood the distinctions that were being made. It's not that unusual. It's not that different than you have under the Mosaic Covenant, going all the way back to Exodus 19, where God says, you'll be blessed if you do the things that I've told you to do, and you'll have hardship and be cursed if you don't. And so the whole aspect of obedience and disobedience comes into play. Let me give you three huge principles to take with you here today. The first principle I want you to see, going back to Joshua chapter 8, is the fact that these stones and this altar were stones on which no man had wielded an iron tool. They were not to be the result of human workmanship. This altar was so important because there was no effort of man really involved. It was a question of just putting these stones together. It wasn't something that they built on their own. And what that shows us is the fact that salvation is wrought by God. It is not man's works that allows us to have a relationship with God. We cannot do anything on our own in order to gain eternal life. We can do good works. We can try our own philosophy at living life. We can try to come up with anything we possibly can. But understand this, it is by grace that we are saved through faith. Not of ourselves, not of our own workmanship. And this is an altar then that points to the grace of God. I want you to notice with me as you think it all through, you think back through that time with Achan and his sin, and you realize that his sin is so significant because it needs to be paid for. And God is the one who is bringing deliverance. So the first huge principle is that this altar is to be constructed of uncut stones, which indicates there's no human workmanship. The second thing is God is pointing to grace and his solution for sin by faith. Notice with me here, and I'll tell you what I mean, in Joshua chapter 8, when he says that on this altar that is constructed, they offered burnt offerings, sacrificed peace offerings. There was to be sacrifices that were made, and this was all part of God's plan. Remember what I said in the beginning? That God, in his holiness, cannot tolerate sin. Sin is the huge issue that we as human beings face. And I don't want to break anything, you know, to you that you didn't really understand before, but let me just say this. The Bible says that there is none righteous, no, not even you. It says none righteous, no, not one, but you can apply that to yourself. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's the reality. There's not one of us who comes into life without a sin nature. All of us have sinned. The people of Israel would find themselves in need of making these sacrifices. And the sacrificial system in the Old Testament was enormously important. When sin came into the world, it required the shedding of blood. And what God does is he's instrumental in obviously constructing a sacrificial system so that the people of Israel could have sins that were covered by the sacrifices. It was called atonement. But it was a covering. It didn't remove it completely. You say, well, how, Pastor Kevin, is that relative to me today in 2017? You and I today still need to have this sin dealt with, and it has to be dealt with by a sacrifice. Oh, great, Pastor Kevin, we're going to build an altar here for next Sunday. No, we don't have to. You see, there's a cross right there, and there was a sacrifice that was made, and that sacrifice was the person of God himself, Jesus the Christ. And he was offered there as our perfect sacrifice, and his sacrifice is so much better than the Old Testament animals that were sacrificed that provided a temporary covering over sin, because when Jesus dies on the cross, now we can have eternal life because our sin is not merely covered, it is paid for and gone. And that's what happens when we come to Jesus Christ and we place our faith in him and him alone. But these sacrificial systems back in the Old Testament were all important if you were to have a relationship with the holy God of Israel. And all of these sacrifices were also important during this time because they all point to one person, and that's Jesus the Christ. How important it is. The third principle that I want you to notice this morning is that Moses gave this command to build the altar on Mount Ebal. And we read in the scriptures that Ebal was the place. I called it Mount Evil in the first service. It's the place where the sacrifices were to be made. It's where the altar was built on Mount Ebal. And looking back at that passage in Deuteronomy, it was the place for blessings or cursings, Mount Ebal. Little quiz for you. It's where the curses were read. You say, why did God have them put the altar on Mount Ebal and not Mount Gerizim? Have you ever wondered that? Here these two mountains are. There's a little bit of a connection there. The people are all seated there. On the one side, the people are saying amen to the curses and amen to the blessings. Why does God build the altar at Mount Ebal? It's because the altar was the place for sinners. And people that don't need to have their sins forgiven don't come to the altar of God because they feel they don't need it. The people of Israel would be reminded with these curses that at times they were disobedient. At times they needed to come and offer sacrifices. Do you ever commit a sin? Do you ever need to come to the sacrifice who is Jesus Christ? Isn't that who we confess our sins to? Isn't that who we have forgiveness of sins with? It is Jesus the Christ. We come to Jesus for forgiveness. And the Bible tells us that's exactly what he does. He forgives us and gives to us eternal life. John chapter 4, we read about a time in Jesus' ministry where Jesus is ministering in an area called Samaria. Samaria was looked down upon by the Jewish people because it was in Samaria where the people were not fully Jewish. They were part Jew and part Gentile. It made them Samaritans. Jesus goes there and he encounters a woman, the Samaritan. This woman of Samaria offers to draw water for Jesus. Jesus is going to teach her some significant things. Jesus would say to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water," speaking of him, "will thirst," or speaking of the well, "will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I'll give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become to him a well of water springing up to eternal life." And the woman said, "Sir, give me this water, so I'll not be thirsty nor come all the way here to draw." She didn't understand it. She was thinking of a physical water that would just absolutely remove her thirst. And Jesus has to point out some issues that she has in her life. Now, I want you to see this in John chapter 4, because the woman, after Jesus really kind of touches that nerve, he says to this woman, he says, "Go and call your husband and then have him come here." And it was like, oh, you probably could have heard a pin drop. Because here's this Samaritan woman, and she's thinking to herself, this woman of Samaria is thinking to herself, I don't know how to tell him that the guy I'm living with is not my husband. And she says, "I have no husband." And Jesus says to her, "You've correctly said, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one who you now have is not your husband. This you have said truly." And she would go on and she would say, "I perceive you're a prophet," to Jesus. And then in verse 20, she says this, which is very curious. She says, "Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you people say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship." It was interesting that she would appeal to her spiritual ancestry. Jesus has really hit the sin on the head, and now she feels convicted. And she looks at that conviction and she says to herself, "Yeah, but you people say it's in Jerusalem, but we here worship on this particular mountain." You see, the problem was with her self-righteousness, wasn't it? Now, the interesting thing about the people of Samaria and where they worshipped, they had built an altar. But did they build the altar on Gerizim or Ebal? Well, the right answer would be Gerizim. You see, Ebal was the place you came to offer sacrifices as a sinner. But now they had the altar at Gerizim. Because the problem was their self-righteousness. You and I battle with self-righteousness, don't we? We need to come to Jesus. If you're here today, you need at some point, in order to have eternal life, you need to come to Jesus the Christ. And you need to see him as your only way of salvation. You need to see him as the only one who could remove your sin. Only Jesus. The woman at the well thought to herself, well, I'm not that bad. And the amazing thing is she goes on and she talks to Jesus and she talks about the Messiah coming and how she's looking forward to the Messiah coming. And Jesus has to look her right in the eye and say, I am he. But here's the amazing thing. If you're really looking forward to the Messiah coming, why are you making these life choices? Why are you living this way? You see, the real answer there is that, well, on the one side of her mouth, she said, I look forward to Jesus coming. She didn't look at her heart and realize that she was doing wrong. You see, she had deceived herself. And so she wouldn't come to that right altar. Because she didn't see her need of deliverance. Every single one of us who have been forgiven by Christ have seen our need of a Savior, haven't we? And we've come to that altar because we know we need forgiveness. That's why we are followers of Jesus Christ. There are so many spiritual lessons to be learned. But the blessings and the cursings that are before the people of Israel are profound. Will you do life according to Joshua chapter 7, or do you want the blessings that are associated with chapter 8 and doing it God's way? That's the choice. But understand that if you do it the way of Achan, there'll be curses. And understand that if you do it according to God's way, there is blessing. As the people of Israel have gone into the promised land, we see a neat analogy here because there's an analogy to us in this Christian life. Those of you who are here today who have placed your faith in Jesus have decisions to make. I have decisions to make every single day. Well, am I going to do things God's way or am I going to do things my way? Kevin, do you want to hear the blessings or do you want to hear the cursing? Do you want to live life as a spirit-filled believer, demonstrating the fruit of the Spirit, or do you want to demonstrate the fruits that are associated with the flesh? That's a decision you're going to make. In fact, it's a decision that you make many times, no doubt, every single day. Think of that scenario of the people of Israel. Because what God was saying to them is, I'm here to bless you. I want to pour my blessings out on you. But there is a great contrast between the blessings and the cursings. And chapter 7 and chapter 8 give us a beautiful picture of that contrast. Make that decision today. How do you want to live life? Do you want the blessings of God? Let's pray. As we bow our heads before the Lord this morning, let me encourage you to stop and think with me for a moment. Would you ask yourself the all-important question, do I have a relationship with our God? In other words, have you placed your faith in Jesus Christ? There are many who are like the woman at the well, deceived, thinking to themselves, I don't have any needs. But the Bible's clear in teaching us that we all have spiritual needs, every one of us. And that spiritual need can only be met by faith in Christ alone. Have you placed your faith in Christ? Maybe you're here this morning and God's working in your heart, tugging at your heart, really. And maybe you're here this morning and you would yield to the Lord and say, Pastor Kevin, pray for me. God's at work in my heart today. Maybe you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Kevin, I know Christ is my Savior and I haven't been choosing His way all the time, even though I see how amazing His plan is. What an amazing plan for capturing AI. And that's our God. He is amazing. And He's given us a plan for blessing. Maybe you've been following your own pathway and you've got to acknowledge this morning that things aren't turning out the right way. Maybe you'd come to the Lord this morning and say, Lord, change my thinking. Help me to pursue your blessings by doing things, doing life your way. I wonder this morning if God's speaking to your heart about any of these things that you would say, Pastor Kevin, pray for me. If God's speaking to your heart, I'd love to do that. Just slip up your hand if you would before we stand and pray. You'd say, Pastor, pray for me. God's at work in my heart. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Let's all stand, shall we? Our Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. We think back to the Old Testament. We think of the sacrifices of the people. Your willingness, Lord, to implement a system so that they could have a relationship, or so that you could have a relationship with them and they could have a relationship with you. And then for us today to think of the work of Christ, the sacrifice that was made for us. So amazing, so rich. Father, help us, Lord, today to choose life. Help us, Father, to choose to be delivered from our sin by faith in Christ Jesus. Help us, Father, also to pursue after righteousness and receive the blessings that you have for us. Be with your people today, these who've raised their hands, Lord, at work in their hearts, Lord, as the Holy Spirit of God. May you continue that work and make decisions that are made here this morning bear much fruit in their lives in this coming year, I pray. Give us, Lord, just a great week ahead, I pray. We don't know what good and bad might come, but Father, we're thankful that no matter what the circumstances of life entail, Lord, we can be blessed by your great hand. And we thank you for the knowledge that we have of this. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.